On this episode of Doing the Most, we're talking about temperature-controlled fermentation.
Homemade brews and various ideas, everything from meat to roast. Big creation, fermentation, inebriation, doing the most.
What is temperature-controlled fermentation? Well, you may be aware that some yeasts operate really well at very specific temperature conditions. Some yeasts really like to ferment cold. Other yeasts really like to ferment warm. Some yeasts are kind of oblivious to the temperature they're fermenting at. And you may be aware that yeasts kind of have a preferential range for where in the temperature range you should be fermenting. And so a lot of wine yeasts that are used in home winemaking, for instance, are yeasts that are selected because they do well in an ambient temperature range that you might find at home. Other yeasts kind of don't really care what temperature range you ferment them at and can be fairly clean and active at low and at higher temperatures. And then there are yeasts like Kvike strains, some of which throw off all kinds of fun and funky esters at really high temperature ferments. Other yeasts, like one of my favorites, D47, when you take it out of its typical fermentation range, produce some really funky esters that take some time to age out. There are other yeasts, like lager yeasts, many of which prefer very low temperatures and have a range of various temperatures that you kind of walk them through to achieve different things throughout the process, from fermentation to diacetyl rest to the lagering process. Despite what you may hear on the internet, yeast is not just yeast. Many strains do many different things at many different temperatures and under many different conditions. And your yeast selection and the temperature at which you ferment are really crucial decisions that you might need to make about whatever it is you're brewing. One of the reasons I like D47 and also K1V1116 is that they produce really clean but also floral enhancing esters at lower temperatures. So if you're able to ferment in the mid to higher 60s with those yeasts, you can get things that really complement honey well in something like a mead. And as I mentioned earlier, Kvike yeasts like Hothead or Hornendahl or Voss do fun things in the higher temperature range, like in the mid to high 90s. They can throw off big citrus characters or big hoppy kind of floral, funky, green tea-like flavors. It can be a lot of fun to play with Kvike yeasts in, you know, the summertime when it's nice and warm and you can ferment something outside. A wine yeast like QA23 in the low to mid 80s can produce really flavor-enhancing tropical notes that go well with tropical fruits like pineapple or mango or even coconut. And honestly, for like a go-to reference on a majority of the yeasts that you're gonna find at your local homebrew shop, Scott Labs actually publishes a wine handbook every so often that gives really in-depth information on a lot of different yeast strains. And I'll put a link to that down in the description of this video. There are a few different methods for temperature control. Obviously, if you watch the weather and you know a temperature range is gonna stay pretty much constant in your area, it's fairly safe to do your fermentation outside as long as you've got protection around that airlock to make sure it doesn't get knocked off. But there are some technological ways you can do temperature control also, one of which is using a fridge, like this NewAir beer froster. I'm really thankful for NewAir for sending this to us, because specifically they sent it to us for this video, for this experiment that you're gonna see here in a little bit, where we did a lager two ways. One was done temperature controlled in this fridge, and the other was fermented out just in the ambient temperature of my studio. This fridge in particular is super cool. I've got it off right now because it was kind of humming by my ear, but it's super cool because it has a turbo mode. This button right back here is the turbo mode. Press that and room temperature beers will be frosted within 1 hour. And I've accidentally hit it a couple of times while kind of like walking by in this room, And I promise you, it goes from regular fridge temperature to frosty really quick. And it's a pretty cool feature of this fridge. We actually moved it up into this room because Anna has been using it as she has been on maternity leave. So right now, there are a bunch of snacks. Oh, there's some maple syrup in there, but there's a bunch of snacks in there that she's been using to stay properly nourished as she is in here with our new baby girl. Big shout out to NewAir for supporting this video. There's gonna be links and stuff in the description so you can check out the beer froster fridge. I highly recommend it. It's a super powerful fridge. It's got a lot of cool features, great light, and really good temperature control that I was able to use to really dial in the temperature on this lager ferment. And it's big. This is a big fridge. You can definitely get several 1 gallon carboys in there, but you can probably get a 3 gallon carboy in there too if you're wanting to do temperature controlled ferments inside of a fridge, with the bonus option of having a bunch of different shelves that you can put in there so you can load it up with beer for game day. Thank you, NewAir, for the support of this video. Another method for temperature control would be to use a water bath, a hot water bath, you know, fermenting where you've got your carboy or bucket partially submerged in some warm water, maybe like in a bathtub. Next level on that would be to put a sous vide probe in there, so that way you're cycling the heat and making sure that it's always at a constant temperature. You could also use a heating pad made for like germinating plants. Put that underneath your carboy or bucket, and that ambient heat will kind of keep things in the right temperature range as the fluid dynamics inside your brew kind of churn and move that liquid around. It's not a great solution, but it works as a low budget solution. If you're trying to keep things cool, obviously a fridge works really well. Some fridges that don't have temperature control, like this NewAir fridge, you may need to use something kind of advanced, like an Inkbird temperature controller that actually cycles the fridge on and off to maintain the right fermentation temperature with inside that fridge. These solutions usually will have a probe that goes up and kind of through and around your airlock and stays inside the bucket or the carboy. So that way you're measuring the temperature inside the carboy or inside your bucket rather than just the ambient temperature inside your fridge. That's important because fermentation generates heat, and the larger amount of brew, wine, mead, cider, beer that you have going, the more likelihood you have that the brew is actually going to raise the internal temperature inside your fridge. So having a probe thermometer that goes down into the middle of the brew ensures you're controlling the temperature of the brew, not just the temperature inside the fridge. A totally lo-fi way of doing that would be to use a probe thermometer, same kind of thing that you would use on poultry, and just making sure that you keep an eye on the readout of the thermometer and change your temperature setting on the fridge to ensure that you're keeping the right temperature in there for the range that you're trying to hold. Now, I know this all sounds very complex, and it is kind of next level stuff. Temperature controlled fermentation is not something that I really practice a lot. For recipes for the channel, I like to really make sure that they're repeatable for you at home, and that typically means trying to make sure that things are fermenting at the right ambient temperature that might be in somebody's house. But for certain ferments, like a lager or a big boy Kveik brew where you want to throw off a ton of big esters, temperature control does become more important. And it can be a lot of fun to play with different temperatures and see what they do to different yeasts. And to put this to the test, I decided to do an experiment where I brewed one batch of lager using the same grains, the same brew process, the same yeast, just split into two carboys, but fermenting them with completely different temperature control. Here's what that experiment looked like. For this experiment, I decided to brew up a very simple lager. I went down to the local homebrew shop and asked them to put me together a lager grain bill. My buddy Tanner there asked me what I'd like to brew, and I said, just, you know, surprise me. I came back an hour later, and he had put together a grain bill for a Schwarz beer. It's a dark German-style lager. I brewed that up as a 2 gallon batch with the intention of splitting it later into 1 gallon batches, and so the entire beer was brewed as one single batch. That way I could keep everything as consistent as possible for this test. This is a very simple beer that I did on the stovetop.
just milled my grains, did a brew in a bag, couple of hops additions. Very, very simple stuff. I chilled it down to yeast pitching temperature. And then I racked it off, splitting it into 2 1-gallon demijohns. Also, I had boiled off just a little bit more than anticipated, so I topped it up with a little bit of spring water, and then I confirmed that both of them had exactly the same starting gravity. I fit them with some airlocks, and one went into the studio to be fermented at room temperature, while the other went into my NewAir beer froster, and I dutifully kept an eye on the temperature throughout fermentation. So this fermented at 49 degrees Fahrenheit. And after a couple weeks, once fermentation had finished, I slowly raised the temperature up to 65 degrees Fahrenheit for the diacetyl rest. Then over the course of a couple of weeks, every day I dropped the temperature just a few degrees until I got it back down to cold crashing temperature. Then I let it set at cold crashing temperature for a couple of weeks before I brought it out to bottle it. Here you can see the difference between the two batches. This is the one that fermented warm, and this is the one that fermented cold. Went ahead and bottled those separately with priming sugar to get them primed up, and a few weeks later, they were ready to taste.
So we had a beer that was fermented as one batch, split into two smaller batches. One was just fermented at room temperature, while the other one was taken through the whole lager process of doing it at a very cold fermentation, bringing it up, taking it back down, doing it at a rest for the lagering process, really making sure we controlled every step of the way of the temperature of that fermentation to make sure we had exactly what we wanted in that beer. You can implement a very similar process for wine yeast you love if you're making wine or mead or cider, and really have an excellent A-B test comparison where you can see the different characters of the yeast at those different temperatures for yourself. And I would recommend that you do that because it's really informative as you're learning these next level techniques in homebrewing. So since this was ready for tasting, I had a couple of friends come try it out and tell me their thoughts, and I wanted to see if they could figure out which was the temperature controlled brew and which was the one just left to its own devices. Okay, so I'm not gonna tell you what these are.
Okay, great.
We're just going to, they're two different bottles. Uh-huh. We're gonna talk about the differences that you sense between the two.
Okay.
I am biased because I know what they are. So it would be inappropriate for me to color the results with my opinion.
Wildly inappropriate. It's good. I mean, it's very dark.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, very dark.
Stick my nose in the foam.
There's a little bit of tannin going on, but it's really light.
So I made an oatmeal raisin cookie stout, mm-hmm. and this is like super similar to that. Has like that kind of fruitiness from like a raisin, but it's got like, of course, the stout maltiness to mm-hmm. it.
I mean, I would think that this is something like a brown ale, just a really dark brown ale.
Okay.
And I don't know if that's a caramely note or a chocolatey note. I can't really distinguish, but.
This has a little more fruitiness to it, like mm-hmm. dark fruitiness that reminds me of raisins, grapes, grape mm-hmm. juice, kind of that side, which can be perceived as sweetness mm-hmm. when really you're just tasting more fruitiness.
I don't know, I like it. I just think it tastes good.
Okay, let's move on to the taller glass, which was this one.
Okay. Definitely smells different.
Well, it definitely has malt. There's malt, there's kind of like nutty. It kind of tastes like a little bit like a peanut butter porter or something like that.
There's a nuttiness in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also good. Similar tannins, not getting any of that nutty chocolatiness though.
Mm-hmm.
I really like this for one. It's okay. Pretty smooth. It's got a lot of, it's really, like it's got some perceived sweetness, but it's still dry. Like it's dried out my tongue quite a bit, which is mm-hmm. interesting.
I'd say this one, the flavor is a little flat compared to the first one.
Again, a small amount of like bright floral something, mm-hmm. but I don't know that it's honey.
There's something citrusy in this that I did not pick up in that.
Okay.
It's got like coffee-ness, coffee side. It's got the nutty maltiness to it. It's definitely like, I mean, it tastes like a stout to me. It tastes like, you know, you go to the Patriarch and get a pour of a coffee porter or whatever. Mm-hmm.
This one would probably be cleaner, but this tastes more like a commercial beer.
It's got a good level of body. I noticed a lot of nuttiness in the beginning of this one and a lot of malty roastiness, and I still get that here. I feel like I got a little more fruity sweetness, perceived sweetness from this one.
Okay.
But I don't, aside from that, the bodies feel the same. I mean, everything else feels kind of similar.
Okay. By your palate, you believe that these are two very distinctly different things. Like, as far as your
yes.
experience,
yes.
not necessarily what they are, but your experience, like, you believe that you would be able to pretty well pick out which is which.
Like, if you gave me a glass of each after I
tasted like, if
these.
I poured another glass and put it down here.
Yeah, I could tell you which one it was.
Yeah, they're very different.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you ready to find out what this is?
Maybe.
This was an experiment using NewAir's beer froster fridge. I brewed up 2 gallons of a Schwarz beer, which is a dark German lager.
Okay.
It is a dark lager.
Okay.
So in America, most of our lagers are light.
Yeah, like I was
light
thinking.
Light amber color.
Yeah.
The beer was brewed in exactly the same pot.
Okay.
And I fermented one at room temperature, doing zero temperature control. And the other I took through the standard lagering process where you ferment it cold, bring it up a little bit warmer for the diacetyl rest. Uh-huh. And then slowly bring it back down and age it at cold crash temperatures.
Okay.
So one batch had very exacting temperature control. The other one sat over here in the corner. Can you guess which one had temperature control and which one brewed at room temperature? So you believe the first one
was with proper temperature control.
Okay.
I mean, I'm gonna go with this is the one that was at room temperature.
You're correct. So as you can see, it's fairly obvious that there is a difference between temperature controlled brews and ones that are just kind of left to do things at room temperature. But sometimes the results of those different brews might lead to different flavor preferences on the palate for the people tasting them. It's up for you to decide, and it's definitely something I want to convince you to think about when you are crafting your brews. As you're selecting your yeast, are you thinking about what temperature would best complement the ingredients and flavor profile you're trying to build within your brew, given the choice of yeast that you've selected? I asked our community their thoughts on yeasts that don't really require a lot of temperature control, because obviously it's important to really think about what benefits our yeast. But also, if we're just looking for some quick cut and dry ferments, it's also kind of nice to know what yeasts don't require a lot of thought about what climate is going to be surrounding your carboy. And the top 4 picks that we heard from our community were EC1118, which is a champagne yeast. Definitely can ferment at a variety of temperatures, best done kind of around room temperature. There was also Kvik Voss or Lutra, both were highly recommended. Lutra is a great choice for clean ferments. Voss, when fermented at higher temperatures, can throw off some citrus esters, which might enhance a brew or might detract from a brew, but it's pretty good at just regular old room temperature. People also recommended 71B, which if you look at the data sheet, does have a very large range of acceptable fermentation temperatures. And for lager yeast, specifically for fermenting lagers at warmer temperatures, 3470 was the recommended lager yeast. I hope you learned something in this video, or at least I hope it put a bookmark in your brain for the next time you're selecting your yeast to think about the temperature of the room or the closet that it's going to be brewing your brews in. If you found this video helpful, I would love it if you joined us somewhere in the community, even if it's just joining our Discord server to become part of our Discord community. And thank you for subscribing to the channel. If you haven't subscribed yet, I can't imagine why, but you should. So click that subscribe button down at the bottom. Make sure to ring that bell for notifications of upcoming videos. We do a lot of homebrewing content here on Doing the Most. And of course, cheers. The holidays are coming up. You're probably brewing for friends and family. So cheers and happy brewing.